Scott's doing a rigging ring down there. Just use the rigging ring, okay? I mean, just walk away. Don't even use the hobs at all. Yeah, no hobs at all. And then a couple later, we can add a little bit. He's taking that one in half because of the trees that'll do. Hey, pick one up. Ballast run. Take that whole thing the way it is. No, it's going to pull back too much. Never mind. To pull back
to the truth.
Back to your left, Matt. Take it up to your left if you leave it here. No. I can do a couple cranks on it.
No. You want to let this thing drop.
Alright, hold it there.
can't.
And nothing. Shit. Holy shit.
Alright, go ahead, David.
What are you gonna cut, Lance? What are you trying to do with this piece?
Hold it for a second so it cracks over and then a nice slow run.
Alright.
So I guess probably a wrap, right?
See a bigger point?
That's it.
Yeah, I see
bigger
it.
Point toward the beach. Yeah, it's going this way, so.
Alright.
Did something break out of the top of that tree? Or that all, well, it was all that limb there?
Rip off the lower piece.
Yeah. Lay down there where the lunches are, Matt. Lay the bunch where the lunches, you think?
Does that look good right there?
No, let me pull a little bit. Right there, that's...
Hold that. Let's get a show. Let's get a saw on that. Who? You're about to lose that. Get a saw. Get a saw. Okay.
Come on, Randy. Get that piece and rotate that way.
Don't look down anymore, Adam. All right, if you want to lay it there, that's fine.
Just lay it right there, Matt. Stop fighting. I'll cut it up and help you get it out.
Hold that. Whoa. Come on. Down. There you go.
Good job, Daniel.
Yeah. One hand on a camera, the other hand on a brush. Sexy. Randy! It's hung up, dude. Jesus Christ, look at that. Can you believe that? Right by David's rope there. You see that little... I mean, it should come out of there, but Jesus Christ, that's unbelievably unlucky.
If we could actually... Hey, David!
What?
To shake this piece out, we're going to grab your rope right here.
All right.
It's dead oak, man. Strong shit. There we go.
You
have to slap it, the power down. Let this go, but we got that slap probably again. Alrighty then.
Ready.
Ready?
Oh.
I'm gonna go for breaking that dead limb off, okay, Matt?
Yeah.
What?
Cut that off. I think it might be dead.
Who's that?
What?
Yeah,
huh? I cut it off.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I didn't like it.
Yeah.
grab onto that thing and kick it off.
Oh, you said you were going to do it.
Not me.
Oh, I'll do it.
Doesn't matter what I do.
All right.
I mean,
all right, let me send the saw there. Lars, can you go down and help out with that hop saw? I told you, I was cutting it, going down and getting the hop saw, and then you were going to jump on it.
No, I don't need to jump on it.
All right.
I'm not... I can make videos about myself later.
You got a handsaw on you?
Yeah.
If I can just get that broken limb, you get it. Right.
Yeah, I was thinking you could kind of...
That was a sick joke.
All right, I'm rolling. Yep. Hold on, here we go. Let's hear it.
Yeah, had a long day fooling around, wrecking some trees out, having some fun, mixing it up, showing each other different stuff, trying some different stuff. Didn't necessarily have to get as complicated as it did, but that was part of the fun. You get a couple guys, these guys are really good, been doing a long time, showing me a thing or two. I guess I might show them a couple of the new things that they don't ordinarily play with. It's good. It's how you learn.
Cool. So let me ask you a question. Are you a member of the ISA?
Yeah. ISA certified municipal specialist. I'm also a member, yeah.
Now, would you say you got most of your training informally or formally through those organizations and the trainings that they provide?
As far as book knowledge or not, like, tree anatomy, and you're talking about I don't know a lot about diseases and bugs and fungus, but stuff like that, and just basically how the science behind how a tree works and grows, and I got that a lot all through ISA and reading in the books and the materials and the seminars. As far as rigging and climbing and all that other stuff, mostly kind of experimenting a lot, always kind of learning from other people and just sort of playing around myself and picking up bits and pieces. I mean, you can learn something from everybody, at least one thing, good or bad. You can always learn one thing.
All right, so basically what I'm hearing you saying as far as like tree biology and that's stuff that the ISA does pretty well in teaching, but they really don't do that good a job in teaching the rigging and the climbing technique. Like, they're behind. They don't teach any advanced stuff, do they?
I wouldn't say to a point, actually. I've looked at their material, and by the time I looked at that material, I'd already known most of it. And that might have been because by the time I discovered it, about 3-4 years in, that I'd already picked up that stuff. Like, are you talking about the... that spiral bound rigging book they got with the test in the back and all that stuff. It's a decent book, and a lot of those tricks, though, you know, I already knew most of them. There's a little thing here and there that I picked up, but a lot of that stuff, if you're in this business for a couple years and you're working around people that know what they're doing, or you go out on your own to try and figure it out or just experiment, you'll figure out a lot of that stuff.
How would you rate their overall educational material, though, as far as the job that they're doing as far as educating arborists?
When it comes to all that stuff, like I said, anatomy, physiology, how a tree works, stuff like that, is really good, because there really is not many other places to go find that information. You could read, now the internet's got everything, but not so in depth, and that they sort of tie it all together. As far as advanced rigging and stuff like that, I don't really think there is a very good place for that. And this
doing stuff like this, working with guys who've been doing it 20, 25 years, unless you have access to that, it's really hard to take it to sort of the next level. And you may never need to even do that. It depends on what you're working with, where you're working, your job situations all the time. If you're, say you're out in Colorado and you're wrecking spruces all the time, it kind of doesn't matter to you. But if you're in an urban area like where I live, you got to come up with some stuff. You know, you got to think outside the box, so to speak. Or like you working out in big trees out in PA, and you got to close around the house, and you can't go to the book for that. It's a valuable experience, you know, and you learn a lot by trial and error.
Right on. What advice would you give to like young climbers? What would you say to a young guy trying to start off and get started in the business?
Stay in school. You sure you want to do this? It's hard work. There's no fooling around. If you really want to do this, just know that it's not all macho, stick your chest out, I can do it, now I'm a bad motherfucker type shit. I think if you want to get the most out of it and learn the most, you gotta remain humble and always think about what it is that you don't know. And so then when it comes along, you won't be too full of pride to learn it. You know, a lot of guys get to a point and they think, you know, the top dog. So I've been doing this 10 years and I don't think I'm that good. You know, I feel like I'm a decent climber or a decent rigger and stuff like that. But I don't like to compare myself to other people too. So I always feel like I can learn more. You know, I can always improve myself. And if you have that mentality, then you always will look to improve yourself.
Beautiful. Really well put. Anything else?
Stay safe out there. Chop, chop.
All right on. Thanks, bro.
It's like 9/16th line or something like that, and a steel carabiner. I was like, yeah, I don't need I don't need that big fat 10X thing with a block. I'll just use this. It's so much lighter. And I blocked wood off that thing for a little while. And then one day, I dumped a proper oak log into it, and it exploded it right off the tree.
Do you ever use, what's that super strong stuff?
Amp steel,
yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I have
for rigging blocks.
I have a half inch, 15 foot amp steel sling, dead eye sling.
Nothing gonna break that.
No, they say you're not supposed to shock load it. Really strong stuff though. Try not to shock load stuff anyway.
I was using 3/8 for a while.
Yeah?
Yeah, did a pretty good job.
I got amp steel on my winch. On my pickup, 20,000 pounds, and it's like
7/16.
I don't know the size.
I think it's 7/16 for 20,000. Yeah.
Well, it's 19 something, but I say 20 because it's rounding up.
Right.
I could round down to 18, but.
All right. What were your thoughts for today's job there? What do you think?
I think we're having fun. That's what it's all about. For us. What makes it fun? Different things make it fun for different people. For me, I like getting in the right spot to capture it. So I think we did that today. Know what I mean?
Cool.
Gotta stare down the barrel of the gun.
Anything else?
No, I'll think of something after you're gone though.
Okay. How about you, Randy? Any thoughts for today?
Yeah, it was good. It was good. It's always satisfying to be able to pull off something like that without breaking anything or killing anybody.
And the close calls make it that much sweeter, huh? Matty, what do you think of that piece that flew over my head, huh?
Oh, yeah.
Was that a surprise or what, huh?
You got a nice little dodge there.
Yeah, that's cool, right?
You're quicker than I thought.
No, I didn't have the camera on.
Okay.
But I saw it swinging right at us. I'm like, okay, here it comes. And then it was just like, almost like in the script, you know, just, it didn't hit anything. It just happened to just let go. It just, the, perfect time. I'm going to walk that off to see how many feet that is. I'm guessing that's like 35, 40 feet from where the cut was made.
Yeah, right.
Vertical distance.
Daniel?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, bro.
Thank you.
Yeah. Any thoughts for you today, Dave?
Any thoughts?
Yeah.
Are you rolling?
Yeah, we're rolling.
I'm tired.
Feeling tired?
I'm most thirsty forever, so. As soon as we got to the ground, I ran and got water, because everybody's cotton now. We had the sun beating on us pretty good. It's a really cool tree. It's really, I mean, you go out there in these big limbs, and it was just like, man, it's too bad it's dead. But anyway, you got to enjoy it before it's down, so. Play again tomorrow with it.
All right.
All right.
Hey, everybody. It's Daniel Murphy out here in Maryland working with Arbor-X Incorporated, Dave Driver, Matty D. August came out from Grants Pass, Oregon. Got Lauren Shultz down here from New York. We had a great day today. We did a couple different jobs. This beautiful tree died, unfortunately, bad construction process here. And I want to tell you about something I learned today. This piece was being rigged out, and it was just a 30-foot piece of dead oak, and it was swinging down, and we were standing 45 feet away, and that piece, as it swung down and started swinging back up right at us, a branch, I guess maybe yay big, broke off, and just at the perfect place in the pendulum to catch perfect air, and actually I just ducked, it flew right over my head, walked it off. It was over 53 feet from the place the cut was made to where the branch landed. That's a long way for a branch to go. So when you got dead oak like this, I mean, I guess part of the lesson is, you know, you'll never get done seeing new stuff in this business, no matter how long you've been doing it. When you got,
I told you it was gonna happen. I said, get out of the way. You guys just gonna throw a limb at you. And I was in communication with Matt, and he's like, all right, Daniel says all right, Dale, it's all right. I said, it's not all right, move out of the way. And they said, it's all right.
So after he told us to move out of the way, we moved out of the way. We were like 35 feet away, but we moved 50 feet away, and the thing flew over our heads still, flew over my head. Matty was right there, saw the whole thing. I don't know, August, did you see that up? You didn't see it, the tree was blocking your way when you were shooting that. You didn't see that swing, did you?
I missed that part.
Okay. Anyhow, that was my highlight of the day, man. So it was like all in the script. I just watched the thing come at me, and then it just let go and right over my head. So Dave, you saw it, right?
I saw it.
Yeah. That was fun. Anyhow, so I guess the point is, when you're swinging big limbs, be careful. Like, you know, don't think I'm 50 feet away from this tree and therefore I'm swinging a limb, it's okay. Like, let's say that limb's gonna swing towards the house. If that's 50 feet away, that you'd have been through the window. So, I don't know.
If you're in the path of the sweep the entire way, you get out of that sweep. What I'm trying to get them to do, get out of the way.
hold on, stop. You're about to do something cool.
When I was 16,
on that same subject that Daniel was talking about.
It's a fun one.
A lot of work. Okay, Daniel?
Yeah, we're rolling, bro.
All right. On that same subject about things being thrown in the path of where they're going, when I was 16 years old, an older brother was taking down a tulip top and stripped it out to a Y like this. Well, we were way down in the woods, down a hill, and he told us to pull on this line and pull this top out. And this top came out and slammed the ground. This was about 10, 12 feet long and maybe 8, 10 inch diameter, probably 10 inch diameter. Well, that force slapping that ground, snap that, boom, helicopter cartwheeled. Through the woods, we were probably 100 feet down in the woods past the yard edge, this thing's coming at me, helicoptering after me. And I wanted to move. It's like slow motion in my mind, but I couldn't. And it went straight over my head, about maybe 5-10 feet above my head. Went way down this hill and hit the stream, probably 500 feet from the tree that we dropped it on. And if that thing was, like I said, 8-10 feet lower, it would have taken my head right off. And that's when I learned, watching him, you don't drop wise like that, especially on a brittle tree.
Yeah.
You really try not to drop wise and let them slam. Or if you do, understand that it can throw something really far and it better not be anything in that direction.
And I would say in particular on tulip, that's something you got to watch.
That's right.
I actually have, I got pictures in my phone here. My buddy was up in this tulip tree. It was no more than 2 weeks ago. And we were taking like a 60-foot top out of this tree. He was probably 35 feet up. It was a big tree. And he, when that piece came down, I was in the skid steer pulling. So my view was obstructed. But he told me a piece cartwheeled like 15, 20 feet in the air and went over the garden. And I looked over the side of the house, and there's like a 4-inch, 5-inch piece of tulip, maybe 6 feet long, right through the siding of the house.
Oh, really?
But fortunately, this is where luck comes in. You guys call me lucky? Okay, you can call me lucky on this one. Fortunately, and that was 25 feet from where the piece hit. You know, it was tulip, and it was like, and the piece fell here, and the house was that direction there. Just a piece got weird, you know? But fortunately, that corner of the house had been hit by a storm-damaged tree, and the whole house was under construction. I pulled the piece out of the hole. I peeked my head through the hole, and the whole house was all down. That whole corner of the house was all down the studs. There was no drywall, no insulation, nothing. So the guy's contractor fixed it and charged me $100. Took $100 off the top of the tower. I said, "Now you want to call that lucky? That's lucky." Yeah. All right.
Wow.
Yeah, and tulip. That's what tulip.
Yep.
Yeah, tulip doesn't.